Good evening. I'm Jeff Bennett.
And I'm Amna Nawaz. On the NewsHour tonight, over a million people are displaced and hospitals face a critical lack of supplies as Gaza prepares for an Israeli invasion aimed at destroying Hamas.
House Republican infighting stymies efforts to elect a new speaker and keeps congressional business at a standstill.
And the murder of a six-year-old Muslim boy in Illinois leaves Arab and Muslim communities on edge in the wake of the war in the Middle East.
We've seen a week of horrific anti-Muslim, anti-Palestinian rhetoric, and it has culminated in the loss of this young boy's life.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Leonard and Norma Clorfine, and Koo and Patricia Ewan.
Actually, you don't need vision to do most things in life. Yes, I'm legally blind, and yes, I'm responsible for the user interface. Data visualization. If I can see it and understand it quickly, anyone can.
It's exciting to be part of a team driving the technology forward. I think that's the most rewarding thing.
People who know BDO.
The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world at Hewlett.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to the NewsHour. Another night of Israeli airstrikes in Gaza and Hamas rocket fire into Israel as Israel's massive invasion force sits on the border poised to strike. At the far southern end of Gaza, the main border crossing with Egypt remains closed as aid waits to go in to help support Palestinians and to allow foreigners in Gaza to leave.
Meantime, the combined death toll is now nearly 4,100 with almost 2,800 Palestinians killed and more than 1,400 Israelis killed, mostly in the October 7th Hamas terror attacks. And the NewsHour can now confirm that 2,000 U.S. troops have been told to be ready to deploy in response to the war. Layla Milana Allen again starts our coverage tonight.
Packing up and shipping out. Israel continues calling up army reservists by the hundreds of thousands to fight what it promises will be a devastating retaliatory war against Hamas.
Since yesterday, we've seen preparations for this conflict start to roll out on a massive scale. Tanks and artillery rolling down the highway on civilian trailers commandeered by the army, in their thousands, going to amass on the southern Gaza border in a huge show of force as they prepare for an almighty battle.
And all those vehicles and soldiers need fuel to run on. Yarit usually manages this gas station on the southern highway. It's been closed since the attacks, like other shops and restaurants across the country. With all its staff called up to fight, there's no one to work. So she's come to staff the checkout counter and keep it open. Several of Yarit's friends were murdered in the attacks. As her country mourns and plans its vengeance, she says she wants to do her part.
It's like they came into my house and shot me. That's really how it feels. So I came here to provide service for soldiers and people in spite of my fear and worries.
Like so many others here, Yarit is determined to fight back, but terrified of what that fight may bring.
This is a war of uncertainty. We won't be the same after it. There's the life we lived before and the life that we live now after what happened.
As bus after bus of soldiers rolls past on its way to the front line, they steel themselves for what awaits. Having beaten back hundreds of Hamas fighters after a long, brutal fight on the border with Gaza, as Israeli soldiers carried out the grim job of clearing victims' homes, they found a new source of terror.
In the villages that were attacked by Hamas on Saturday, the Israel Defense Forces found a huge cache of weaponry, thousands of pieces, and they suspect that Hamas planned a much longer fight.
Scattered amidst the carnage, hand grenades, anti-tank mines, artillery rounds, North Korean-manufactured rocket-propelled grenades, improvised rocket launchers, and, vitally, Iranian-made mortar rounds, the first material evidence that Iran is directly supplying weaponry to Hamas in this fight.
This is made in Iran, no doubt about it. We knew they have those, we knew they have mortars, but these Iranian mortars, this is the first time that we see it on this battle.
It's taken bomb squads more than a week to safely disarm all these munitions. And now, here they sit, deep in an Israeli base. A testament to the sheer scale of the firepower Hamas has stockpiled. As Israel plans its attack on the miles-long network of Hamas tunnels that lie beneath Gaza, its soldiers can only imagine how much more awaits them there. But sitting above those weapon-stacked tunnels are defenseless civilians. For days, crowds of Palestinian dual nationals have waited anxiously at the Rafah border crossing with Egypt. With Gaza under constant bombardment and under siege, this is their only escape route. Journalist Qasem Al-Katharna holds American citizenship.
Well, this is war in Gaza. This is war in the people who's suffering, not the military. We have to leave your mother, your sisters, your neighbors. It's the worst trouble in my life to leave right now.
Mahmoud and his daughter hold Swedish nationality. They've been trying to get out of Gaza since Saturday.
My daughter saw people die, saw children die. We've been sleeping here at the crossing point. There's shelling from every side and every corner.
The Rafah crossing in southern Gaza is controlled by Egypt. It's a vital link between Gaza and the rest of the world. But it was shut down nearly a week ago after being hit by an Israeli airstrike. Since then, no one has been allowed to leave, and desperately needed humanitarian aid has stopped trickling in.
Rafah will be open.
U.S. officials hoped the crossing would open today for a few hours, but talks with Israel and Egypt to reopen it have so far failed. Sameh Shoukry is Egypt's foreign minister.
The Israeli government has not taken a decision that leads to the possibility of opening the Rafah border crossing from Gaza's side.
A few miles north of Rafah, in the city of Khan Yunis, there is no let-up in the Israeli bombardment. Before the war, the city was home to about 400,000 Palestinians. Now, more than a million after Israel ordered people to evacuate south. With hundreds of thousands displaced, a fast-growing humanitarian crisis has erupted. These men do what they can to feed fellow civilians. With no fuel left, thanks to the blockade, they cook with firewood.
There is no stove, and we can barely find firewood. I kept telling people they have to wait to eat.
Against this backdrop, Secretary of State Antony Blinken was back in Israel today after meeting with leaders across the Middle East to try and stop the conflict spreading through the region. But speaking to Israel's Defense Minister Yoav Gallant today, he emphasized U.S. support was rock solid.
You know our deep commitment to Israel's right, indeed its obligation, to defend itself and to defend its people.
On Israel's border with Lebanon, tensions are high. The militant group Hezbollah released video footage of themselves destroying Israeli surveillance cameras. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu addressed the Israeli parliament today.
I have a message to Iran and Hezbollah. Don't test us on the northern border. Don't get back to the mistake that you did once. Because today, the price that you will pay will be more expensive.
As violence escalates, the State Department has begun evacuating American citizens from Israel by sea.
And that violence is escalating fast. Today saw hundreds more rockets fall on both sides of the Gaza border and exchanges of fire across the northern border with Lebanon, even as Iran's foreign minister warned that the country might now retaliate against Israel even before a ground invasion of Gaza. Jeff.
And Leila, you were down near Gaza today. Give us a sense of what the preparations for this Israeli ground invasion look like.
Well, as you saw there, just a staggering amount of armor and artillery being shipped into the south of the country. And of course, hundreds of thousands of these soldiers who've been called up, really walking down the highway with their packs, jumping into army jeeps, just being shipped out onto different border posts, but also the evacuations, because of course these areas are already being hit with so many rockets. And now if there's going to be a full-scale war, they need to get people out. Some people willing to go, some people desperate to stay, saying, where on earth would I go? I've lived here all my life.
So what then are the options for Gaza now and the people they are trying to escape?
Well, there are two issues here. The first is what to do right now with this humanitarian crisis that's brewing in the south of Gaza. People were told they had to move down to the south of Gaza. That's where they would be safe. Even as they started to move a couple of days ago, convoys were hit by airstrikes on the road as families tried to flee. Then they were told to go down to the south, and they were told that there was a small pocket around the Rafah crossing that would be humanitarian zone. They approached it, and there was a strike on the Rafah crossing. Now the Rafah hospital has been told to evacuate, and they've already got people coming from all the other hospitals in Gaza. Khan Yunis, the biggest city in the south of Gaza, is being struck every day, even though hundreds of thousands of people have evacuated there. This is not sustainable. They need to find a way to make these people safe and find somewhere that they can go where they've been told to go and stay there. The next issue is what happens is if there is a full ground invasion. Currently, the Egyptians saying no way that they will open the crossing, the Rafah crossing, for everyone, only for foreign nationals. But that hasn't even happened yet. If they can at least get Palestinians with foreign passports out, that will be a significant reduction. Thousands of people will be able to get to safety. Can they build a huge refugee camp around the Rafah crossing? The Egyptians would have to agree. The UN would have to get involved. Of course, great concern. Already 1.5 million Palestinians living in refugee camps around the region. They don't want another one. And finally, there's the existential issue. Many people are concerned that this is going to be a version of ethnic cleansing, that if people leave Gaza, they will never be able to come back. They will lose their land forever, and they're terrified about that.
Leila Moulana Allen joining us again tonight from Tel Aviv. Leila, thank you.
I'm Vanessa Ruiz with NewsHour West. Stephanie Tsai is on assignment. An update now to our top story tonight. President Biden will travel to Israel on Wednesday in a show of support for the U.S. ally. Biden will also meet with Arab leaders in Jordan to discuss humanitarian aid. A 6-year-old Palestinian-American boy was laid to rest in Illinois after police say he was fatally stabbed by his landlord. His mother was also seriously injured but is expected to survive. Police believe the man targeted his tenants because of their Muslim faith in the wake of the Israel-Hamas war. The Justice Department has opened a federal hate crime investigation. The Biden administration has reached a settlement with migrant families separated at the border under President Trump. If approved by a judge, the agreement will grant them temporary legal status and prevent similar separation policies for 8 years. Brussels is under its highest level terror alert tonight after two Swedes were fatally shot in the Belgian capital. Belgium's prime minister said the attacks were linked to terrorism but did not give specifics. Police arrived at the scene and sealed off a neighborhood while the gunman is still at large. The shootings forced the suspension of a soccer match between Belgium and Sweden taking place at a nearby stadium. Poland's opposition parties appear to be on the verge of ousting the country's ruling conservatives. Turnout in Sunday's election was at an all-time high after 8 years of divisive policies. The centrist opposition celebrated as the preliminary results came in their favor. Final results are expected tomorrow. Meanwhile, voters in Ecuador have chosen center-right candidate Daniel Noboa to be their next president. The 35-year-old heir to a banana empire will be the country's youngest leader ever. Supporters celebrated on top of cars after Sunday's runoff and waved flags in the streets of Guayaquil. In his victory speech, Noboa vowed to rebuild Ecuador's economy amid a surge of drug-related violence.
I want to thank all the people who've been part of a new, young, unlikely political project whose goal was to give the country back its smile, to provide education to the youth, and provide jobs to the people. Tomorrow, we start work for this new Ecuador. We start working to rebuild a country seriously battered by violence, by corruption, and by hate.
The U.S. Supreme Court reinstated Biden administration regulations on ghost guns, self-made firearms that are difficult to trace. Today's temporary order reverses lower court rulings that exempted two internet sellers of gun parts from the rules. The regulations will remain in effect while legal challenges continue. And a passing of note. Actress Suzanne Somers died Sunday at her home in California after a 23-year-old battle with breast cancer. Somers was best known as the effervescent Chrissy Snow on the sitcom Three's Company. And later, she became a spokeswoman for Thighmaster and wrote dozens of books on health and wellness. Suzanne Somers was 76 years old. Still to come on the NewsHour, the war between Israel and Hamas raises major questions about diplomacy in the region. Tamara Keith and Amy Walter break down the latest political headlines. And a new translation of the Iliad into modern language reinforces its relevance, and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington, and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The House of Representatives is entering a third week with no full-time speaker for the first time in our country's history. The Republican majority is set to meet again tonight. There, Speaker nominee Jim Jordan of Ohio will look to sway dozens of colleagues who just voted against him last week. Congressional correspondent Lisa Desjardins is at the Capitol. So, Lisa, House Republicans are planning a floor vote tomorrow afternoon. How close is Congressman Jim Jordan to securing the votes that he needs?
He has a ways to go still, as our reporting right now. But this meeting tonight could be critical in determining what happens for him. House Republicans went home exhausted by their own indecision last week. They've returned now with a little bit more rest. The ones I've seen have a little bit more spunk in their step. But they still aren't saying too much different than last week. There was a time when Mr. Jordan did speak to reporters earlier today, though. Here's what he said.
The best way we can help the American people is get the House open. We can't do that until we get a speaker. So let's get a speaker tomorrow and get back to work for the American people and help our dear and closest friend, the state of Israel.
Are you preparing for this to go multiple rounds tomorrow?
We're preparing to get a speaker tomorrow.
That with my colleague Rachel Scott from ABC News. Now, let's look at the math problem, really. This is what this all comes down to at this moment. As viewers may remember, what Mr. Jordan needs to become speaker is about 217 votes in his favor. If he gets that, he would win. That's plan A. But plan B, this is how Mr. McCarthy became speaker, was a lower number. In this case, he needs at least 213 votes, but with opponents voting present, not voting for someone else, but voting present. How many votes does Mr. Jordan have right now? Well, at the end of last week, he had 152. However, this was the news today, Jeff, that one by one, Jim Jordan has been able to reverse some of his opponents, getting some support today. That's something Steve Scalise wasn't able to do. An example is Ann Wagner of Missouri. She's a diehard Steve Scalise supporter, but she came out with this statement today saying she had a long conversation with Jim Jordan. And in the end, among the reasons she is now voting for him, is she says, he allayed my concerns about keeping government open and with a conservative kind of number for the budget. Jim Jordan was one of the architects of the whole government shutdown idea.
So, Lisa, if Congressman Jordan can't get to 217 votes tomorrow, what happens?
A few things could happen. He could withdraw, like Steve Scalise, but I think it is more likely that he would try and keep going on the floor, as Kevin McCarthy did. At some point, this could just become intractable. There are some who are saying it's time to vote in for more powers for Speaker Pro Tem Patrick McHenry. And, of course, there is still discussion about whether Democrats and some moderates will get together. I still don't think there's the momentum around the Republican Party for that yet.
All right. Lisa Desjardins. Lisa, thanks as always.
You're welcome.
A federal judge in Washington imposed a narrow gag order on former President Donald Trump in the election subversion case against him. It bars Mr. Trump from targeting special counsel Jack Smith and his team, as well as court staff and potential witnesses. It does not prevent him from criticizing the Justice Department. NPR Justice correspondent Carrie Johnson was in the courtroom today and is with us now. So, Carrie, this partial gag order, how does it work and what does it cover?
You know, it covers some of what the Justice Department asked for, but not all of it. As you mentioned, former President Trump is on the campaign trail. He's free to criticize current President Joe Biden. He's free to criticize the Justice Department as it's led by Attorney General Merrick Garland. And he's free to say things about Washington, D.C., where he's scheduled to go on trial here in 2024. But former President Trump will not be allowed to attack the special counsel Jack Smith or any members of Jack Smith's team. He will not be allowed to attack any courthouse staffers or workers, and he will not be allowed to attack potential witnesses in the case. People like former Attorney General Bill Barr and former Joint Chiefs Chairman Mark Milley, among others. Trump will be allowed to personally attack the judge in his case, Tanya Chutkan, and he's continued to do so this afternoon, even after the gag.
Did the judge say what would happen if Donald Trump or the other parties in this case violate the gag order?
You know, the judge set out a pretty broad continuum of what might happen, from a stern warning or financial penalties to possible home detention or even incarceration before trial. But she didn't say how she would escalate that or what she would do if Trump or anyone else, any of the lawyers in the case, violated some of these rules. She did say, though, she would be willing to impose some sanctions. We just don't know what yet.
Carrie, remind us why this was even necessary, why the special counsel requested this gag order in the first place.
Yeah, let me take you back to the day after former President Trump was arraigned on four felony charges here in D.C. One day later, he posted on social media, "If you go after me, I'm coming after you." And since that time, he's attacked the special counsel Jack Smith, calling him deranged, calling his lawyers a bunch of thugs. He's called the judge a radical Obama hack. He's basically said former Joint Chiefs Chairman Mark Milley potentially should be executed or face execution. He's beat up his former Attorney General Bill Barr and, of course, had a lot of criticism for his former Vice President Mike Pence as well. All of those people are likely to be witnesses against him at this trial, and the judge and the Justice Department were concerned about witness intimidation and damage to the administration of justice and also taints to the jury pool here in D.C.
As you mentioned, Donald Trump has already blasted this gag order. Here's a bit of what he had to say at an event in Iowa today.
This is weaponry all being done because Joe Biden is losing the election and losing very, very badly to all of us in the polls. He's losing badly. But what they don't understand is that I am willing to go to jail if that's what it takes for our country to win and become a democracy again.
So Donald Trump's attorneys have said that they plan to appeal. They say that this gag order is fundamentally antithetical to his First Amendment rights. What does the law actually say, Carrie?
You know, there's not a lot of law on this at the Supreme Court. We haven't had cases where defendants have been gagged pending trial, and those cases have gone all the way up to the highest court in the land. But what's clear is that Judge Tanya Chutkan, who will preside over this trial next year, has said is that just because you're running for president doesn't mean you have unfettered First Amendment rights. Donald Trump is also a criminal defendant, and he's not supposed to influence witnesses who might testify against him.
Carrie Johnson of NPR, always a pleasure to speak with you. Thanks.
Thanks, Jeff.
The brutal murder of a six-year-old Palestinian-American boy named Wadia Al-Fayoum on Saturday has left a community grieving and fearful about growing anti-Islamic sentiment during the Israel-Hamas war. His father spoke shortly before his son's funeral today.
I am here because I am the kid's father, not because I'm political or religious or anything. I am the father of a child whose rights were violated. I hope this wakes us all up.
I'm joined by Edward Ahmed Mitchell. He's a civil rights attorney and national deputy executive director of the Council on American-Islamic Relations. Edward, welcome. So Wadia was buried today. He just turned 6 years old a few weeks ago. Tell us about this boy. Tell us about his family. What should we know?
This young boy was like any other young boy. He loved sports. He loved drawing. He loved his family. He was a young man with a promising future that was stolen from him in an act of anti-Palestinian and anti-Muslim hate. I wish I could say that our organization was surprised by this, but we're not. We've seen a week of horrific anti-Muslim, anti-Palestinian rhetoric, and it has culminated in the loss of this young boy's life.
Tell me about his community. They live about 40 miles outside of Chicago in Plainfield. What are you hearing from folks there?
I think everyone is shocked and stunned. Obviously, they've been horrified to see the violence happening overseas, impacting Israelis and Palestinians and others. But for it to come home and impact them directly was not something they expected. So I think everyone's rallying around the family, trying to support them, and also sending a message that this is the danger of anti-Muslim and anti-Palestinian hysteria, and we cannot let this happen again. No one else should have to go through what this young boy's family is going through right now.
As it's been reported, Edward, this little boy was stabbed 26 times. His mother, 12 times. She survived. We should say she's in hospital recovering. The sheriff's office there said that the man charged was their landlord, 71-year-old man named Joseph Zuba, and targeted them because they are Muslim. The Justice Department says it's now opening a federal hate crimes investigation. What's your reaction to that? Is that welcome news?
The FBI is doing the right thing. This absolutely does appear to be a hate crime. The landlord, interestingly enough, was previously friendly to the family. He even helped build a treehouse for the boy. But then, over the past week, he became furious over what he was seeing in the news. He went to the apartment, started an argument with the mother, said that Muslims needed to die, tried to kill her, and when she managed to get away, he killed her son instead. This is clearly a hate crime, and the FBI should act accordingly.
You know, we've seen statements now from President and First Lady Biden, from Vice President Harris, Second Gentleman Inhofe, condemning the attack, saying hate has no place in America. We've also seen a number of statements, largely from Republicans, including a candidate for president, Ron DeSantis, saying the U.S. should be rejecting all Palestinian refugees at this time. What kind of impact do those statements have on the general public?
Well, I would say the American Muslim community has been extremely disappointed with the statements we've heard, not only from people on the political right, but also the political left. There has been a week of anti-Muslim and anti-Palestinian rhetoric. Almost feels like we're back to the years after 9/11. We've seen just the complete ignoring of Palestinian suffering. We've seen hysteria whipped out about the supposed threat of Muslims and Palestinians in our country, and that has consequences. So I'm happy to see President Biden and others condemning this sort of violence and sort of hate. But they need to speak up for all human life, all Palestinian lives, and say that this is always unacceptable. And we should not have to welcome refugees from Gaza. We should be protecting the people of Gaza so they can stay there in their homes and not be forced out of their homes due to the Israeli government's bombing campaign. But to the extent some refugees do come here, certainly they should be welcome.
Edward, as you know, there's been a generation of Muslim Americans, of Arab Americans, who know how fast and how dangerously anti-Islamic and anti-Arab rhetoric can take hold and spark violence. We saw that after 9/11 here in the United States. Israel has now called this attack by Hamas their 9/11. Have you seen anything else that leads you to believe there could be more attacks of this kind that killed this little six-year-old boy?
If the anti-Palestinian and anti-Muslim rhetoric and hysteria that we saw over the past week continues for weeks to come, I am concerned about what would happen. But I do want to emphasize one thing. The American Muslim community is not going back to the years of the post-9/11 America. We were subject to discrimination and bigotry. Islamophobia was out of control. We're not going back to that. We are a strong community, a confident community, and no one is going to bully us into being silent about the suffering of the Palestinian people or bully us into not going to our mosques or not praying. We're living our lives. We are going to carry on, God willing. We would just encourage our neighbors to speak up for the safety of all people, and we encourage our political leaders especially to do that.
In the 30 seconds or so we have left for folks out there who are fearful as a result of this attack, what's your message to them?
Be safe, be vigilant, be cautious, but carry on. Be an activist, be a worshiper of God, do what you would normally do, but just be careful. And we should be doing that all the time, given all the threats that exist here and around the world. But we cannot let anti-Palestinian or anti-Muslim extremism scare us away from doing what is right and living our lives.
That is Edward Ahmed Mitchell, National Deputy Executive Director of the Council on American-Islamic Relations. Edward, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
The Hamas terrorist attack into Israel shook the Middle East and threatens to expand far beyond Gaza. Nick Schifrin examines the regional consequences, as well as efforts to confront a humanitarian and hostage crisis in Gaza.
Over the last 5 days, the U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken has visited 7 countries across the Middle East, one of his most intense regional diplomatic efforts. The goals are to prevent the war from expanding, gain release for Hamas's American hostages, and coordinate across the region on humanitarian aid. To discuss all that, we get 2 perspectives. Francis Riccardoni was a career American diplomat with extensive experience in the Middle East and was U.S. ambassador to Egypt during the George W. Bush administration. And Hanin Gadar was a journalist in Lebanon and has written extensively about Hezbollah. She's now a senior fellow at the Washington Institute for Near East Policy. Thank you very much. Welcome to both of you to the NewsHour. Ambassador Riccardoni, if I could start with you. Officials tell me that it is largely Egypt that is blocking the opening of the Rafah crossing through which Gazans would presumably leave Gaza and humanitarian assistance would presumably enter. As far as you can tell, why would Egypt be resisting opening Rafah?
The Egyptians have a long and complicated history with Gaza, the Palestinian Authority, and Israel and the United States over this. And this is not a sudden problem or something new with this latest flare-up in what is at least a 16-year-old war. You can argue when the war actually began. The Egyptians have serious national security interests in at least containing Gaza, but the Egyptians had wanted much more than that over the years. It's not enough, in their view, simply to contain the people of Gaza and the Gaza problem. In the long run, a two-state solution is what the Egyptians have always favored. When I was ambassador, the Israelis pulled out their settlements, the IDF pulled out their occupation and worked to seal it off. It became U.S. policy, working with Egypt, to help seal that border. It was U.S. policy to promote elections in Gaza against Egyptian warnings and Israeli warnings, which resulted in Hamas coming to power, in a great irony. The Egyptians do not like Hamas. They see it as a wing of the Muslim Brotherhood and therefore a national security terrorist threat to them. They, in the short run, they don't want Hamas bleeding into Egypt. In the longer strategic run, they do not want Egypt to be the solution to the lack of a Palestinian state for the Gazans. They do not want a transplantation of the population of Gaza to Egypt.
And why should those security, why should those strategic imperatives block Egypt being more helpful when it comes to humanitarian aid?
Probably for much of the same reason that the Israelis are not about to open the land border or the sea border or the airspace. The Egyptians, as I understand from the latest announcements, are in fact prepared to have some sort of very controlled, very carefully managed opening to let some people out. It sounds like that is happening, and I expect it would be very limited and carefully controlled.
Hanin Gadar, take us to Israel's northern border with Lebanon at this point. What do you think the likelihood is of Lebanese Hezbollah opening up a second front?
Hezbollah has been very careful. They are very calculated so far. They are still playing within the rules that were set after the 2006 July war with Israel. They haven't really attacked Israel beyond the northern border, military posts, radars, telecommunications, nothing beyond that. They don't want to risk losing all the benefits that they have reaped from this war. They have so far, the gains are much higher than the losses, and they do not want to change this equation. If they go into the war, their calculations today is these gains are still very vulnerable, and they haven't been translated in political and diplomatic gain internationally. So they don't want to risk them until they have to, until this turns into a regional existential war for them. Hassan Nasrallah, Hezbollah's leader, hasn't said a word yet. This is very telling. It means that they are still watching, observing, deliberating the next steps, but they haven't made a decision to go full-scale war. Iran has Hezbollah's strongest card is in Lebanon, is Hezbollah, and they don't want to lose it because Hezbollah's precision missiles, Hezbollah's other missiles today that are pointed at Israel are much stronger as a threat. And if they use them, they will lose them. And they know that. And this, they will be exposed to a big war without any guaranteed victory that they can claim.
The U.S. has moved its largest aircraft carrier off the coast of Israel. A second aircraft carrier is currently sailing toward the Mediterranean. Does that deter Lebanese Hezbollah?
Yes, absolutely, because I don't think their calculations included such a strong response by the U.S. Despite all their statements, they understand the risks of a war that would involve the U.S. They totally understand that was not something that they were expecting, and this is not something that they would ignore.
Let's zoom out now. Ambassador Cardone, first to you. U.S. officials tell me one of the main goals, of course, of Secretary Blinken's travel is to get hostages out, especially American hostages. The IDF said today that there are over 199 hostages being held by Hamas in Gaza. This involves Qatar, Egypt, Hamas, and Israel, a real regional push. Even if you don't know the details, how would those conversations be going right now that the Secretary of State is leading?
In the very first place, there have to be channels for those conversations. I have to hope that there such channels exist. Those probably are through the Egyptian intelligence and security channels that did exist. Perhaps the Qataris had them. The Turks at one time had them. And I have to presume that that's why the secretary is in the region right now, trying to activate those channels to get word through to them somehow. But then the question becomes what to say, what to induce them beyond the public statements of cease and desist.
And Hanin Gadar, U.S. policy toward the region for years was focused, in the words of one senior U.S. official, at keeping the region off the president's desk. More recently, the U.S. has been focused on normalizing relations between Israel and Saudi Arabia. Do you believe that normalization effort right now is at the very least frozen?
At the very least frozen, yes, absolutely. It's very apparent that this is one of the main goals or the main benefits that the Iranians have reaped from this war with the Hamas attack, whether it was intentional or not. This is definitely something that the Iranian regime is exploiting today. They realize that it's not just the normalization with Saudi between Israel and Saudi Arabia. It's what it really represents for them, because it really finalizes or takes the region in a different way in terms of the new Middle East led by these efforts by the West, more economic focused, more linking the Israel via the Gulf to India. This is more of an economic link that is mainly isolating Iran and its proxies. And Iran got the message how isolated they are today from the new Middle East, or the Middle East that is going in a very different direction, especially economically. The Saudis today are in a position where they can't really ignore what's happening today and continue with the normalization efforts. Something's got to give before they go back. So I would say for definitely it's at least frozen, and everybody in the region sees it that way.
Hanin Gadar, Francis Riccardoni, thank you very much to you both.
Thank you very much.
From the House Speaker race to new fundraising halls in the 2024 campaign for the White House, there's some big election news to break down with our Politics Monday team. That's Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report with Amy Walter and Tamara Keith of NPR. So lots to talk about. Glad to have you both here. Jim Jordan, he is shoring up support ahead of this speakership vote tomorrow. What's the word from the White House, Tam, about a potential House Speaker, Jim Jordan? Steve Scalise, when he was the nominee for all of 1 or 2 days, Democrats were saying that he was somebody that they could work with. What's the word on Jim Jordan?
It's not, oh, we can work with this guy. Though President Biden was asked about the possibility of a Jim Jordan speakership about 10 days ago, and he was like, well, there are other people who I would have an easier time working with, but I'll try, was basically the message. I checked White House visitor logs. Jim Jordan hasn't been to the White House during the Biden presidency. He went to the White House a lot during the Trump presidency, including to get an award from Trump at the very end and various meetings and other things. he hasn't been to the White House during the Biden presidency for things like a Christmas party or a congressional picnic. It's just not a thing. There is no relationship. However, I've spoken to people who have known Biden for years and say, he'll figure this out. He'll figure out how to work with whoever he has to work with. But let's just remember, Jim Jordan is actively investigating President Biden, pursuing an impeachment against President Biden, has basically railed against every budget deal ever, and now is potentially the person who the White House will have to deal with to keep the government functioning. This could be a real challenge for the White House in terms of governing.
Yeah. Well, there is the question of, can Jim Jordan get these 217 House votes? There's also this additional question of, should he? Should he be House Speaker? Should someone who actively tried to overthrow the election and thwarted with, coordinated with Donald Trump behind the scenes to thwart Joe Biden's win, is that someone who should lead the Republican Party and who should be in the line of succession? What does that say about the Republican Party?
Well, that is the question, right? You also, if you go into the Republican conference and had a vote that was completely anonymous and said, how many of you really want Donald Trump as our nominee? Majority of that conference would say, no, we want somebody else. They will not say that publicly. They say a lot privately too, same things about Jordan. But publicly, they're in this place that they've been really since the Trump era. You make a decision to go against that wing of the party, you either vote for an impeachment or you say something on the campaign trail or you speak up and speak out against somebody like a Donald Trump, and you are punished in a primary, or you are, you know, basically told that we're not interested in you. So if you are part of that wing, I would call them, and they would call themselves the governing wing of the party versus, or we'll call them the Trump skeptics versus the Trump folks who, the people who really like Donald Trump.
Hards.
Yes, the Trump diehards. The skeptics have a choice in front of them. They either say, we're not going to pick Jordan. We don't know who's next. We know nobody else can get to 217. And so we're going to live in this chaos of the government literally not able to function for the foreseeable future. Or we can get behind Jim Jordan, who in the short term will allow Congress to function. But in the long term, we're going to probably be back where we've always been, which is getting in a fight to keep the government open, because Jordan is not going to be particularly interested in negotiating with the reality, which is there's still a Senate controlled by Democrats, mm-hmm. and there's still a White House president. So that's where that wing finds themselves. They say, we want to govern, we want to get things done, we don't want any more chaos. And yet the people that they're supporting publicly, getting behind, even though privately they're not happy with them, are the very people that are making this chaos a reality.
Tim, using Amy's point of the short term, long term, I understand you spoke to a Democratic consultant who said in the long term, this could be great for Democrats.
Right. So Democrats do actually care about governing. So in the short term, it is pretty problematic to be facing down potentially another government shutdown in the middle of next month, right before Thanksgiving. However, the campaign ads will write themselves, is what this consultant was telling me, that they are going to be able to say, look at this extreme Speaker of the House. Here are these Republicans who claim to be moderates, who come from suburban districts that Joe Biden won in 2020. This person who claims to be a moderate is following the orders of an extreme MAGA Republican who was involved in January 6th and tried to overturn the election and all of these other things. And they're going to try to paint, and we'll probably have a pretty easy time of it, paint all of these Republicans who will be running for re-election in 2024 as just part of that side of the party.
And we should say a House Speaker does more than just preside over the House. He or she is also expected to raise a ton of money.
That's right.
And
yes.
Kevin McCarthy was a phenomenal fundraiser. Right. He mm-hmm. raised like $22 million just this past summer for the Republican PAC that helped members of Congress. Jim Jordan doesn't have a track record, one, for legislating or for raising money.
Or for raising money. He raised some money for himself, but in terms of being able to get those institutional donors, and those institutional donors are also the same people who right now are trying to organize around an alternative to Donald Trump, who are funding the super PACs that are keeping folks like Tim Scott and some of these, Ron DeSantis, in the game right now. They would like to see someone other than Jim Jordan They didn't mind Kevin McCarthy. They supported Paul Ryan. They gave money to Paul Ryan and John Boehner's organizations. It's going to be hard for them to write checks to Jordan, especially if they think, well, the House is going to flip anyway. Mm. There's only a 5-seat majority that Republicans have. This may be what gives Democrats the advantage to win. So they may be able to hedge their bets here and say, even though they're in the majority right now, we're not going to give the same kind of money because they may not be here for very long.
Well, speaking of fundraising, we got the third quarter fundraising totals for the 2024 crop of nominees, to include also President Biden. You see him there at the top with $71 million. If you look at the number for Mike Pence, raised $3.3 million. What you don't see there is that his campaign is apparently $600,000 in debt, and he had to lend himself $150,000 of his own money. It really reflects the lack of traction that he's getting in this primary. I mean, the fundraising totals in many ways reflect the polling challenges that these candidates have.
Right, and if you look at that graphic, it looks like there are two incumbents in this race, and then there's everyone else, and they are way, way, way behind. And someone like Mike Pence has struggled to gain traction in the primary, has struggled to gain traction with voters, because anti-Trump Republicans see him still as the loyal lieutenant who talked about the broad shoulders and looked dewy-eyed at Donald Trump for 4 years, until one day when he crossed him and he refused, when, as Pence would say, he stood up for the Constitution instead of for Donald Trump, and he became an apostate. So he doesn't have, he's a man on an island. He doesn't have a constituency in the Republican primary. He's making a go at it. He's trying to get evangelical voters. He's talking about, you know, conservatism versus populism and all of these big ideas that would have probably gone over pretty well in 2012.
Yeah. Amy, in the minute we have left, are we at the point now where Republican candidates not named Trump, DeSantis, and Haley need to think about getting out of the race?
Well, even DeSantis and Haley don't have a whole lot of money behind them either. And I think that's the reality right now, which is if you look where we were at this point in 2019, there were a number of candidates who raised a lot of money, a lot more money than this tier of candidates under Trump is raising. And it tells you about where the enthusiasm of the party is. It is with Donald Trump. This isn't about the fact that there are too many candidates or they're splitting the vote. The candidates are not just showing up the voters are not just telling pollsters that they're supporting Donald Trump. The fact that they're not donating to the candidates is another show of the lack of enthusiasm for an alternative.
Amy Walter and Tamara Keith, we'll see you back here next Monday.
Indeed.
Achilles and Hector, Helen of Troy and King Priam, the world of the Iliad, one of the foundational works of Western literature and thought. It's an old story set amid a long-ago forever war that continues to resonate in our time, and it's been given new life in a translation by distinguished classical scholar Emily Wilson. She spoke with Jeffrey Brown in Philadelphia recently for our Arts and Culture series, Canvas.
Images of the ancient Greeks from artifacts in the Penn Museum at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia.
I have an Odyssey side of my body and an Iliad side of my body. This is the bow of Odysseus.
Images of the ancient Greek epics on the body of Penn professor Emily Wilson.
I have an owl on my back for Athena. I have rosy-fingered dawn for the Odyssey. I have the loom for the loom of Penelope. I have the octopus for the survival and changeableness of Odysseus. I have the thunder clouds for Zeus, I have a ship for the ships of the Iliad, and I have the immortal horses of Achilles.
So this is rather extraordinary. You're really living this world.
I live it, and I want other people to live it through the translations, but I live with Homer all the time.
Yes. Now 51, she's been living it a long time. That's Wilson at age 8 reenacting a scene from the Odyssey. In 2017, her translation of that epic, the story of the hero's return home from the Trojan War, gained widespread acclaim. Remarkably, it was the first ever by a woman into English. And 2 years later, Wilson won a MacArthur Genius Award for, quote, bringing classical literature to new audiences in works that convey ancient texts' relevance to our time. Now she's translated Homer's Iliad, set amid the war itself. Greeks fighting Trojans and one another. The great warrior Achilles battling his enemies and, it seems at times, himself.
In the introduction, you call it the most gripping and heartbreaking work of literature I know. In what way? Why?
It's so focused on very intense human emotions. The first word of the poem in Greek is menin, which means a sort of superhuman kind of rage. So we're told right from the
start, anger,
wrath, yeah. Terrible rage. So this terrible cycle of rage and grief that perpetuate one another is absolutely at the center of the poem. And also the mortality of the human body is so central to the poem. So you're always feeling things and learning about how people feel things and about the glittering brightness of our lives while we're alive and how short that is.
The Iliad, perhaps composed in the 7th century BC, was attributed in antiquity to the blind poet Homer. It stems from an oral tradition in which bards perform their work, often playing a musical instrument. It uses a regular pattern of sound or meter called dactylic hexameter.
It's long, short, short, like
so
a finger has. Like that.
And the entire
poem has that regular music all the way through.
English translators, there have been more than 100 of them over 400 years, have used a wide variety of approaches and poetic styles.
White-armed Andromache, among the women, began the keening, cradling in her arms the head of murderous Hector.
Wilson wanted the music of Homer, but in a traditional English form. And think Shakespeare, she chose iambic pentameter.
Before that time, this town will be destroyed. One thing that really drew me to the task of translation was the frustration I felt in teaching Homer in translation with the fact that most modern translations don't have meter. This is a poem. It's not an action movie. It has a regular rhythm to it. I was talking before about the intensity of the emotions. Mm-hmm. If the reader doesn't both feel the rhythm and feel those feelings, then the poem isn't working the way that the Greek poem does. The Greek poem makes you feel the clarity of the narrative and the intensity of those feelings mm-hmm. all the time.
We need the greatest warrior.
Now, if you do like action films, no poetic meter here, there's Brad Pitt as Achilles in the 2004 film Troy. In fact, Wilson points out there's a continuing interest, even a mini renaissance in ancient stories and myths, including best-selling novels like Madeline Miller's Circe, now being adapted to an HBO series. Acting company, a New York-based theater group, recently launched a national tour of an adaptation of the Odyssey using Wilson's translation. And Wilson herself, of course, continues to teach the classics to a new generation of students.
What is most important thing for you to convey to young, especially young students you're trying to interest in?
Just the humanity of human beings always, including in the very ancient past. Mm-hmm. That, of course, we come to a place like this and we sort of see the differences between they fought wars not with guns or bombs, but mm-hmm. with spears and arrows
with
or
helmets
like this.
Yeah.
And yet so much of the feelings are the same. This, the sense of grief and pain have always been part of human society.
Uh-huh. That things are different, but things are the same.
Things are different and things are the same, yes. Mm-hmm. Both of those truths are essential.
Is there still a place for Homer in the classics amid today's culture wars? Wilson thinks they're needed as much as ever.
We tend to be very much focused on our world is the only world. It's not the only world. There are more worlds. Mm-hmm. And antiquity shows us something about how many worlds there are, how many different ways a human being can be. And then at the same time, there are these enormous resonances between the Iliad and our own time. I mean, this focus on violence, the intense partisanship, conflict between not Greeks versus Trojans, but members of the same community living closely together and hating each other.
All this in our daily news.
Yeah. I mean, it's not exactly the same, and yet it has this resonance. Mm-hmm.
How do you think about your own role as a translator of ancient epic?
I want to open up more conversations. I mean, I think history is all about debate, and literature is all about debate. I want to create translations that have enough clarity in the storytelling and enough vigor in the sound and the characterization that they're going to arouse debate and make people think and make people want to talk to each other and discuss what do we actually think about Achilles? What do we think this story is all about? I want the reader to be both swept up in the story and also want to talk about it and feel there might be some questions and that we're allowed to to argue with each other, ideally not like Achilles and Agamemnon and slaughter each other, but argue with each other in productive ways.
Let knowledge of the past, that is, continue to inform the present. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown at the Penn Museum in Philadelphia.
Later this evening on PBS, a film by Ken Burns, The American Buffalo, takes viewers on a journey through more than 10,000 years of North American history, tracing the mammal's evolution, its significance to the Great Plains, and most importantly, its relationship to the indigenous people of North America. Airing over two nights, American Buffalo premieres tonight at 8 p.m. Eastern. Check your local PBS station listings. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Jeff Bennett.
And I'm Amna Nawaz. On behalf of the entire NewsHour team, thank you for joining us.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Architect, Beekeeper, Mentor, a Raymond James financial advisor tailors advice to help you live your life. Life well planned.
The Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org. Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at MacFound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS NewsHour West from WETA Studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.